Welcome to Talks at GS, where leading thinkers share insights and ideas shaping the world. In this episode, we bring you a recent phone call between Salveen Richter and Terrence Flynn of Goldman Sachs Research and Dr. Michael Mina of the Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health around the evolving understanding of coronavirus.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us. Before we get started, we are required to make certain disclosures and public appearances about Goldman Sachs' relationships with companies that we discuss. The disclosures related to investment banking relationships, compensation received, or 1% or more ownership. We're prepared to read aloud disclosures from any issue or upon request. However, these disclosures are available in our most recent reports available to you as clients of our firm portals. Disclosures and updates to these disclosures are available by ticker on the firm's public website. Also, the views stated by non-Goldman Sachs personnel do not necessarily reflect those of Goldman Sachs. Again, just to welcome you all, I'm Salveen Richter, biotechnology analyst at Goldman Sachs. Joining me, I have my colleague Terrence Flynn, who covers biopharma. And with us today is Dr. Michael Mina, professor of epidemiology and immunology, infectious diseases at Harvard School of Public Health, Associate Medical Director in Clinical Microbiology and Molecular Virology at Brigham and Women's Hospital, Harvard Medical School, and a member of the Center of Communicable Disease Dynamics. We look to discuss the evolving understanding of COVID-19 biology and epidemiology and approaches to flatten the curve in the context of diagnostics, potential therapeutics, and vaccines. With that, please do send us any questions over email if you'd like us to ask them on the call. And our discussion today will only focus on public information. We do not want any confidential information. With that, Dr. Mina, thank you for joining us. And to start off here, perhaps we can talk about the sequencing of the virus here. So while we've seen sequencing of the virus, the novel coronavirus, occur rapidly after COVID-19 was first discovered, where are we right now with understanding the biology of the virus? Maybe we can start by putting into context the virulence and transmittability of this virus relative to the 1918 flu, SARS, and MERS.
Sure. So, of course, as more or less as soon as this virus was discovered, the Chinese groups that began sequencing it, and pretty much since then we've had a consistent rollout of sequences to help us monitor what this virus is doing at the population level as it moves through people. To answer the last question that you asked, is to put it in context. Relative to MERS and SARS, it does seem to be a virus that has reduced virulence and pathogenicity to individuals compared to those other two viruses. The caveat there is that we really never actually got a decent understanding of just how many people did get infected with MERS and SARS. There was never massive screening in the way that we are, of course, being forced to do so now or attempting to do so now. So we actually may have missed quite a few individuals during that time, which would have caused what appeared to be a higher mortality rate. Either way we look at it, though, I think that it's pretty safe to say that this virus is a distinct virus. The way that it grows inside of a person when it hits its peak titers is different from some of those other viruses, and it does seem to be less pathogenic, less virulent, but unfortunately more transmissible. And so what's making this into the global pandemic that it is, whereas the other two did not seem to have the same characteristics in terms of global spread, is really that it found a sweet spot of fuel for living between not the most transmissible pathogen, but not the least, and not the most virulent, but not the least. And this is actually very similar to 1918 flu, which probably did not have the highest mortality rate of any virus that we would look at, but oftentimes there's some bit of a trade-off between virulence and transmissibility, and when they find a nice optimum, which this virus seems to have done, we end up getting wide-scale spread and unfortunate excess mortality at the population level. The MERS and SARS viruses, they where they had a dispersion factor, which is if you model what these look like in terms of the distribution of people who transmit it, they had essentially they were driven by super spreading events. And this is to say that many people did not likely spread MERS and SARS, and it was driven by many individuals, which led to high probability of stochastic extinction. And that's essentially what led to the demise of those two viruses. In this case, we believe that it's much more likely that the average individual and not the super spreader is what is driving this epidemic. And it's becoming increasingly clear that it is likely being spread on the contrary by many mild cases adding up to sort of wide scale spread.
Thanks. And have any new strains of COVID-19 emerged? And if so, what are the implications? If not, could additional strains develop? And how do you think about differing characteristics of strains with regard to virulence and transmissibility?
Sure. So there was some report from China that talked about these two strains. In general, that's been debunked by the best virologists in the world. There's no real sense that this is becoming two lineages of this virus. We can monitor the virus, and we can see that it's making it's marching onwards with a mutation rate that is anticipated, and that can essentially serve as a molecular clock, for instance, for us to be able to back calculate different introduction times. In this case, this is not a virus where we're particularly concerned about genetic drifts we might be concerned about. And one of the major differences between this virus and influenza, which is where most of the concern about major changes in the viral structure come from, influenza is a segmented genome, meaning that its genome is broken into a number of different bits that all have to get packaged as it replicates, which allows it to actually swap out major parts of its genome during co-infections, for example. And it has much greater ability, essentially, because of that whole process to make shifts that will ultimately lead to an immunological escape and vaccine escape from individuals, or could lead to greater pathogenicity. This virus does not have those similar types of mechanisms. It's one large structure for its genome that ends up getting cut up into smaller bits during its replication cycle. But what it means is that we can anticipate that there will be mutations that do occur, as with any virus, but we don't anticipate any large jumps happening, with the exception of the extraordinarily rare occasion where something could happen if it's put under enough pressure, for example, from a vaccine or an antiviral. But we haven't seen any real evidence of it changing shape or form or virulence or even transmissibility at this point, at least from what the data is currently showing. And this is still a coronavirus. It's a novel coronavirus, but it doesn't look and act that different than the ones we know of. And these are not viruses that are known to be incredibly unstable and shifting. The four seasonal coronaviruses we have circulating every year have been largely stable over many, many years. So my anticipation is that this virus will behave similarly.
And at this point, what do we understand about the mortality rate here, and why does it appear to vary by geography?
Mm-hmm. So I think that's a very, very tough question to answer. We are seeing in many ways it is probably driven more by surveillance than anything else, but it's also driven potentially by healthcare infrastructure. If we look at China, we see somewhere around the lines of a 3% mortality rate. But that's if we assume that there was truly only around 80 or 90,000 cases that actually did occur in China. My guess is that that number is probably somewhere around 5 to 10 times higher, which would put the mortality rate more in line with somewhere around 0.5%, for example. And that's an issue with surveillance. But if we look in Italy, we're seeing a high mortality rate. And if we look in South Korea, we're seeing a fairly low mortality rate. It's difficult to understand exactly what's driving those differences. Is that truly a surveillance issue? If So it seems South Korea has done a tremendous job at surveying and doing testing across a wide swath of the population, which ultimately drives down the perceived mortality rate. So that, I think, is probably the major driver of all of this. In the U.S., I think our mortality rate is probably going to be pretty high, only because we currently have very low testing. So that's one bit. The other part is certainly access to healthcare. South Korea, Singapore, they were able to very quickly organize as a government and as nations and develop protocols, not just to test, but to also ration supplies and deal with, keep the healthcare crisis somewhat in check. And a lot of that was driven by public health measures to sort of flatten this curve. Italy did not, of course, do that. And we are seeing a healthcare crisis roll out there in the same way we're seeing a similar effect in Seattle. So I think that the implications on healthcare in terms of surge capacity and peaks of the epidemic cannot be overlooked when it comes to what the mortality rate is. If we simply have too few ventilators for patients, we will see increased mortality.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Mina. Appreciate your time today. Maybe just the other, you know, question people have been focused on is thinking about seasonality with COVID-19. So in warmer and, I think, more humid climates, it's believed that virus droplets are less efficient at transmission. Just wondering if the same holds true with COVID-19. Can we look to, you know, Singapore as an example? And what does this mean when we approach summer here in the U.S.?
So the truth is that we're still not sure, and we know that coronaviruses can transmit through the warmer months, but we also know that they are much lower in terms of their transmissibility, at least what we see. So there's either two reasons for this: either the transmission truly does go down, or the pathogenicity and thus the requirement for testing of these normal coronaviruses goes down. And so we could end up seeing, and there's a lot of reason to believe that pathogenicity could be worse in colder climates and drier climates because of the way that the mucosal tissue is made up and the protective barriers that are around when you're very dry, they would be decreased. In terms of the problem here is that we've seen this virus transmit very well and infect many people in warmer climates right now. And so there is a competing force where the force of infection here is just so great with a population that's essentially 100% susceptible still. There is an enormous force of infection. So even if the drier climate would normally send a peak of infection down and into a trough, it's questionable about whether or not the rate of susceptibility will essentially abrogate that this year. And normally when we look at these viruses, we're assuming a much lower proportion of the population is susceptible. And so small deviations in terms of transmissibility can have large impacts. Usually these aren't linear scale events. And so these can often have large impacts in terms of driving an epidemic away from its peak. And at the moment, we're trying to better understand that. I think there is some possibility that that droplets will be, you know, more a major driver than aerosolized transmission, for example, in warmer climates. But it's very difficult to know until we actually see it what that will practically mean at the population level. All we can say at this point is that we've seen this transmit very well in warm climates so far.
Okay, great. Maybe the other question is just on the time course of immunity here. Can we expect, or do we know yet, if once a person is infected, they have immunity? And if so, do we have any data to suggest how long that protection would last? And then I guess a corollary to that is, how long could it take to develop a herd immunity here across the population?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a terrific question. So again, we can look at the seasonal coronaviruses. There are certain viruses that seem to result in really long-term immunity, things like measles, polio, smallpox. They led to essentially lifetime immunity, whereas most viruses that we contend with as humans do not generally result in long-term sterilizing immunity. Coronaviruses we know do not. We know that people can get infected sequentially with coronaviruses over a lifetime. If we look at the seasonality and we try to understand what could be driving the seasonal patterns of seasonal coronaviruses that we see now, in terms of the way that you'll have one strain dominate one year and another strain another year and so on and so forth, we are making some early estimates that it could be that the immunity against coronaviruses is actually pretty limited to between 6 months and 18 months before somebody might be able to be exposed and acquire the infection a second time. And that's actually similar to what we are unfortunately seeing with things like influenza now, where we're seeing that the immunity against influenza will sometimes diminish over just one season. And by the end of the season, if you had it early on, you might actually be at risk again. The benefit, or at least the one piece of good news, is that most likely if somebody does have some pre-existing immunity against this coronavirus, it's very likely that if they get it again a year later, for example, that they would be unlikely to have a very severe infection. And that's because when immunity wanes, it doesn't necessarily mean that you're losing every bit of your immunological protection. Essentially, you're just falling below sterilizing protection. But this isn't a black and white sort of 0-1 issue. This is it will be on some gradient. But unfortunately, what that also means is that if we end up seeing that people can become susceptible again, at least to a small degree, then they could potentially transmit, and we could see frequent cycles of this virus as the years go on. And until we gain sufficient herd immunity to really stop it in its tracks each time, we would likely continue to see individuals who have never been exposed become exposed and ultimately and likely have disease as though it's their first time. And that's particularly with the elderly that we'd be most concerned. So that's the issue at hand. Herd immunity is something that we can, we on the one hand want to get to, but we also really don't want to get to very quickly. And this whole idea of flattening the curve is really in an effort to preserve our healthcare system. But what it ultimately implicitly does is it delays time to herd immunity, potentially in to provide some time to get vaccines and develop sort of synthetic herd immunity through vaccination. But if we are successful, which I think, you know, looking at the United States now, I think we might actually be on the right track to really truly flatten this curve and prevent a major catastrophe like we're seeing in northern Italy. What it means is that we won't end up developing herd immunity. We could see there's a potential that we might only see 0.5 or 1% of the population infected this year, or at least before the summer, and that has benefits and costs to it.
Is there any data? I know it's obviously a ways back, but the 1918 flu, is there any data to suggest how long it took for immunity to develop there, or is that just we don't have the data? I'm just trying to think, is there any analog that we could look to answer that question, or not really?
Well, I don't think we can use 1918 as a particularly good example in this case, because the world is changing its behavior as we speak. Every country has some sort of implementation of quarantine at this point. And 1918 spread so efficiently, in large part because they didn't know how it was spreading. So quarantine measures weren't taken in the same way, and it spread rapidly and killed tens of millions. At this point, I think we are in new territory where the world has responded. Of course, some countries are not. You know, the UK, I don't know what they're doing, but it doesn't look good. I think they maybe came out yesterday and said that their analyses were based on flawed data, which any epidemiologist could have told them. Just to give reference, the UK was planning on controlling this through development of herd immunity through natural exposure, which can be disastrous. For their healthcare system. But in any case, every country, more or less, I think there's a focus being placed on quarantine and mitigating transmission. And so I think that what we will see will be a much more drawn out and extended course for this virus. We'll probably come the fall, we'll see another peak. If it doesn't go away in the summer. My expectation is it will go down. Going back to the other question, is it will go down some. It's just the question is how blunted will transmission be during the summer months remains unknown. But my guess is that we'll see another peak in the fall, and we'll continue seeing that as, until we have some sort of herd immunity. But if we keep doing a good job, we'll still keep reducing transmission. But of course, that is going to come at the cost of our economy if we can't figure out how to be efficient as a populace while still mitigating transmission. And it leads to all these questions, you know, what is the approach? And I think that's really the thinking behind the UK's approach is, let's get this done quickly and build up herd immunity so we can just forget about it in a year from now. But that could, you know, that might come with a huge number of deaths over the next couple of months.
Thank you. And what have we learned to date about viral shedding in patients and what this means for how long an individual could be contagious?
Mm-hmm. So viral shedding is generally one of the major differences between this virus and MERS and SARS is that the virus seems to have its greatest peak viral titers, its concentration in the body, around 3 to 5 days into symptom onset. We do believe that there is probably some viral shedding pre-symptomatically, which we often refer to as asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic shedding, and that can certainly increase transmission if people don't know that they're sick yet. Over the first week of symptoms, we see the virus peaks and then decreases. But usually by around day 8, the virus is no longer at least culturable. We can't take somebody's nasal secretions or swab and put it onto tissue culture in a lab and have the virus grow. So that's a very good sign. But how exactly tissue culture translates to transmissibility in this with this virus is still unknown. And so I think to be safe, for example, quarantine for probably 2 weeks post symptom after symptoms have resolved, I think is a very safe bet for preventing onward transmission. Most likely a 1 week isolation after symptoms have subsided would be appropriate as well, considering the cost of keeping people at home, and that's primarily driven because we do see viral titers peak so early with this virus and then fall down fairly quickly on a logarithmic scale over that first week. There's been reports about finding RNA, finding people being tested positive for weeks or months after resolution of symptoms. This is largely an artifact of the type of sensitive test that we're using. We're detecting nucleic acids, but that is a far cry from detecting live virus and replicable virus. So when we swab somebody 5 weeks after symptoms have resolved and we find RNA from the virus in their system, that could actually be just their immune system holding on to some of those viral bits, whether it's RNA or proteins. And it could actually being used to continue training the immune system, for example. But ultimately, it's unlikely to be a live, culturable virus. And again, we see after about 8 days of symptom onset, we aren't even able to culture virus. And at that point, the titers are still around 10 to the fifth per microliter. They peak around 4 orders of magnitude higher than that. So I think we can anticipate that after 2 weeks post-symptom onset, there would be very minimal spread.
And can the virus transmission occur in patients who are asymptomatic?
That's the concern, and most likely, yes. There are some people, so we have one thing to recognize is that many of the symptoms from viral infections like this are really driven by an immunological response. So in particular, some people might not even have symptoms, and that could actually be worse in a subset of people where the virus could be starting to grow out of control if somebody does not have an inflammatory response that's sort of eliciting danger signals very early on, like fever. Then you could end up getting individuals who end up having asymptomatic transmission of fairly high viral loads without knowing it. Hopefully, if that's the case, you know, or not necessarily, hopefully might be the wrong word, but many of those people might end up going on to have worse symptoms later on in terms of actual respiratory distress. But also even just mild patients, symptoms are very hard to detect sometimes, especially during flu season. People don't necessarily associate some minor cough or a headache with being infected, in particular if there's some element of cognitive dissonance going on. I think saying that somebody's truly asymptomatic is also a gradient, and mild symptoms can often be perceived as asymptomatic. But we do, I think the data is probably pointing more and more in the direction that asymptomatic or mild asymptomatic transmission is perhaps a major route of this.
I know one of the obviously more, you know, timely topics has been diagnostic tests, and I know that's an area that you've been working on pretty extensively. Maybe you could give us an update in terms of where we stand in the U.S. in terms of capacity and, you know, the efforts that have been going on that front, and then maybe how this has differed, you know, across different countries.
Sure. So just to give a two-minute background, the CDC declared an emergency health declaration on January 31st, and that immediately put into place the requirements for testing to be performed under an emergency use authorization by the FDA. That declaration and the requirements for EUA are large departures from the normal workings of laboratories and hospitals, where normally we are given wide latitude to create any test we want for the patients within our institutions, and we can test them. We just can't go and sell those tests outside of the hospital. Under the EUA requirements, we could not produce a test, even if we wanted to, without getting FDA approval. More recently, almost all of those regulations have sort of been relaxed at this point, and things just out of necessity. What we are seeing today is, without going into detail about the blunders that happened in February, ultimately things at the end of February began to get essentially onto the trajectory that they should have been maybe 4 weeks earlier. And the state laboratories now have kits to do testing. And now we're starting to see industry partners like Quest and LabCorp and ViraCorp, Mayo Clinic, ARUP in Utah start to get their testing online. However, most of this is still going to be inadequate. The state laboratories are not designed for high throughput testing. Most of them are still using very manual tests, which is essentially the CDC test that all the news was about for a while, is a very manual test, and it ends up being the instrumentation and the labor, which ends up being the true bottleneck. Most of these tests were not performed on robots, for example. Some of the major manufacturers now, like Roche, do have their robotic tests that are coming online. These are the types of tests that are normally the bread and butter of any major laboratory. And now that these manufacturers are getting their sort of what we call sample-to-answer tests available and EUA approved, we should start to see large increases in the amount of testing capacity in this country. However, Roche, I know, is, for example, prioritizing both hotspots, so places where there is ongoing transmission, which ultimately precludes places with burgeoning epidemics to really be able to take precautionary measures. But also, a lot of these companies are European companies, and they don't necessarily hold any major. They are prioritizing their European counterparts in large part, and so we can anticipate that Roche Diagnostics will continue to be a limited supply in the United States, despite a pretty bold address by Trump with regard to the EUA that Roche rolled out the other day. And I don't have any expectation that we're going to be seeing hundreds of thousands of Roche tests being run every week in our country, just because the reagents are not necessarily there. I know from personal experience here in Boston that those reagents are not accessible to us at the moment, and they are not accessible to the state laboratories either. Hologic has, which is another major manufacturer based in here in Massachusetts, they got FDA approval yesterday to be able to roll out their tests, which is what a lot of other laboratories that don't have Roche instrumentation, they have Hologic. unfortunately, as anticipated, Hologic is, despite their EUA yesterday, they will not have sufficient reagent to actually distribute to the country in any short order. We are one of their priority customers, and I don't anticipate that we will have any reagent within the next month, probably. So that leaves us in a situation where state laboratories are hamstrung. They have very limited capacity, and we're seeing the private sector try to do what they can. Myself, personally, I'm working with the broader Boston community to essentially leverage the biotech expertise and automation and robotics folks here to really increase sampling and testing in Massachusetts and New England. Hopefully we'll have that online next week, but you know that might be a few thousand tests a day max. And for the foreseeable future, I think we're going to see testing remain a huge limitation. We're also seeing normal reagents that we would never consider being out of stock are now out of stock, things like RNA extraction kits and even the nasal swabs that are being used to take the sample from people are now running out of stock. That's something I never thought I would hear myself say. So these are I think this is exposing pretty large gaps in our preparedness as a country to deal with an epidemic, and testing is priority number one usually to control the epidemic early. We might end up getting to a stage where testing just isn't actually that essential if we can start to make presumed positives, but we do not want to have to find ourselves in that position, because that means there's far too many people infected.
And maybe, thanks for the detail. Maybe just a couple follow-ups there. I guess the first one is just in terms of maybe timelines. So you mentioned, you know, some of the robotic tests. Sounds like that's pretty, you know, quick turnaround time. What's the turnaround time for more of the academic or CDC type tests that you referred to? So, you know, if we were able to roll that out a little bit broader, how long would it take for people to find out their result?
Yeah, so I think even with the robotic tests, we're still going to see backlogs. A lot of like Quest and LabCorp and ViroCorp, they are using robots, I'm sure, to do their tests. And ultimately, the problem with those sendouts is that then there's delay in terms of getting the samples to them, getting them processed in-house. I think in general, what we can anticipate seeing on average is going to be, right now we're seeing some places as short as one day. But I think in general, as things continue to ramp up, we'll probably see 2 to 4 day delays.
And then are you able to project, again, I don't know how much visibility you have on this, like where you think capacity will be over the next couple weeks when some of your center, some of the other academic centers ramp up, or is it too difficult to kind of piece that together right now? Just trying to understand the total kind of volume of tests that might be available over the near term.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think epidemiologically, we should be running about 100,000 tests per day in this country, given the size of the country and the spread of the outbreaks. I think realistically in the United States, we might be able to get to around 20,000 tests per day over the coming weeks. I don't necessarily see a straightforward avenue to increase much more than that until I think the Roche reagents are crucial to it. And if they can get those reagents out to any institutions that have the 6800 or the 8800 instruments that can run those reagents, then that could increase throughput quite a bit. Each one of those instruments can run between 1,000 and 4,000 samples per day. But if they're all being prioritized to hotspots, we might not see sort of an equitable distribution of testing, which could ultimately undermine the purpose of testing in places where the outbreak hasn't yet happened.
Okay, and then the reagents, again, this might be outside of your expertise, but is that because of, again, limitations on kind of the processing materials, and there's obviously been a, you know, global disruption of a lot of supply chains, or is it just the capacity of like a plant that makes these reagents? Just I'm wondering if you know any more about what's the limiting factor on the reagents.
Yeah, I think it's manufacturing at this point to a large extent. And this is one of the issues with some of these really nice instruments like Roche and Hologic and Cepheid. These are highly manufactured kits, these tests. And And so unless you go and the more manufactured, oftentimes the easier they are to handle in the hospital labs. And so these are the kinds of sample to answer tests that hospitals often want to be able to use. Some of them can be scaled up like the Roche to be fairly high throughput, but they require a lot of manufacturing. Versus on the other hand, the type of effort that we're taking outside of the hospital system here in Boston to create high capacity testing is entirely on automated robotics instruments that are not wedded to any single company's kit, and we're able to purchase bulk reagents. But even those, we're seeing that there are limitations in the manufacturing. We are getting some of our reagents are coming from a manufacturing company. The actual plant is in Lithuania, for example, and they are just starting. They've been activated to start creating RNA extraction kits, which they're doing, but they're just getting that going now, and they'll hopefully be processing them at scale within the next week or so, and shipping them out to customers. But I think that everyone's just trying to figure out how to shift their companies and their factories over to produce a sufficient number of a lot of these items.
Okay. And maybe just the last on the testing front. So if, there are people out there who want want to get a test, I guess, is it most efficient to go through like a primary care provider, or is it like through an academic center or CDC? Like right now, what's the kind of most efficient way, given how the system is set up for, people to kind of request a test, I guess?
It's changing quickly, but still every test requires a physician order. And in general, there's still a pretty heavy triage of who can get tested. For example, at our institution in Boston, in the hospital institution, we are prioritizing inpatients with urgent needs. We're prioritizing emergency patients who are coming in with what look like severe symptoms. We are then prioritizing healthcare workers who might be exposed. Outside of that, it's going to be very difficult for individuals to get tested. We're starting to see drive-through testing stations pop up. It's not clear to me, and it's not clear to many people in this country how exactly those are working and who's getting prioritized given the limitation of tests. And in some ways, we have this we have become so entirely accustomed to being able to send anything we want to the LabCorp and Quests of the world that that the idea was that as soon as these big major companies came online and they capture somewhere like 50 or 60% of the market share for laboratory testing in this country, those two companies, the idea was that once they came online that everyone would be able to get a test and it would be fine. And I think that's how clinicians continue to think. But the reality is they can't, they don't have the throughput to actually carry that weight. So it will remain unclear to me for some time about how exactly these drive-throughs will happen. What we will start to see over the next maybe month or two, probably two, I think we'll start to see point of care testing potentially come online. We'll also start to see people and companies that, of course, in my opinion as a physician, take advantage of the situation and create create sort of home test kits and charge a lot of money because people are scared. So those might end up coming online and serving as as some sort of ability for anyone to be able to be tested. And it would be something like 23andMe, where you get a little kit at home and you test and you send it in. But short of those coming online and getting FDA approved, I think we will still see that the vast majority of tests are going to be distributed, performed by hospitals and by clinics that deal more with individual level care and have to make these tough decisions to triage. And the state laboratories are some of the main players in that triage approach, where they're giving very clear guidelines on what types of samples they're even willing to accept at this point. And they so I think for the time being we're going to see only the sick patients and maybe their contacts be tested. And hopefully we will start seeing increased screening as some of these other instrumentations come online.
Dr. Mina, maybe one last question here on the tests. How are you thinking about the accuracy rate associated with them?
It's a great question. there is no gold standard for this test, but in general, PCR is very, very accurate. We are now validating even other technologies that are coming out of some companies that are in the Boston area and Cambridge area, for example. And we're seeing good concordance. I think the PCR tests are certainly the most reliable and robust in the sense that they are tried and true, and we have a lot of history of making these reagents and knowing how to make them. So I think in general they're serving to be very specific. How sensitive they are really comes down. The greatest source of variability is the swab, and who is taking the nasal swab and how good of a job they're doing. That is kind of completely separate from the test itself. But of course, from your perspective or from the perspective of somebody not running a test, it's all wrapped up into the same thing. And so I think what we're seeing is the sensitivity is probably going to be around 70 or 80% when we take into consideration the missed specimens because of the sampling procedure. And that does have some ramifications on public health. And it's one of the reasons why if we could have unlimited testing, then we wouldn't have to worry too much. We can have multiple swabs being taken, for example, and really monitor the virus more closely. But at this point, that's not the reality.
Great. And when we look at the latest data coming out of China and Italy, what does it suggest in terms of spectrum of severity, and what is the current protocol or standard of care for treating a severe patient with COVID-19?
Mm-hmm. So the spectrum, I think, is going to turn out, I think the vast, vast majority of people will be so mild that they'll never actually receive any hospital or medical attention. Maybe they'll get a test, but otherwise, I think it's going to be very mild. We'll see a smaller portion of those individuals have to go to the doctor, smaller portion yet have to be hospitalized, and so on and so forth, and intensive care and mortality. But that's just to say that I do think that, that the majority of people who are getting or acquiring this virus are not really going to require hospitalization. And I think that was being looked at in terms of the UK's decision to just try to push herd immunity as the solution. Of course, that leads to a lot of hospitalizations overall. The standard of care of treatment still remains supportive care. And that essentially means that when somebody's in the hospital, we help them to continue breathing. We help them with their fluid intake. We don't yet have a true antiviral. And there are, of course, a few that are under trials that are giving fairly promising results. I'm not directly affiliated with any of those trials, but they do seem to be the early data that's been made public, both from China and now other places. We do see that there's some benefit to remdesivir. How much benefit is going? We'll have to wait till the trials are really completed to see. There were these protease inhibitors, HIV protease inhibitors, early on that China was trialing. There's really no good mechanistic reason to believe that they would have had much of a benefit, and they don't seem to. There's some early data that maybe chloroquine could be helpful. It's, again, I think we would really have to see good, robust data before we actually believe that that's going anywhere. I think probably we'll see a drug like remdesivir. We might see some ACE inhibitors, for example, could end up at least modulating disease. They won't be considered antivirals, but they could actually help to mitigate the severity of disease in individuals just by their role on the angiotensin system inside the body to prevent cardiovascular effects, which this virus seems to be exacerbating cardiovascular underlying comorbidities. And then we'll also potentially see small molecule inhibitors that might be developed. And there's, of course, massive, massive efforts probably by most pharmaceutical companies at the moment getting their hands on viral cultures and screening for huge numbers of potential small molecules in some targeted fashion. So that's kind of where we are at. At the moment, standard of care remains supportive.
With regard to the patients on the severe side of the spectrum, you know, there is concern about hospital systems in terms of resources and ICU beds. Can you just walk us through what steps your institution is taking to prepare? And then secondly, based on the increasing availability of diagnostic testing and social distancing and the current trajectory, you know, what is your view here on kind of the front as to where we stand now?
Yeah, so hospitals in this country are certainly running out of personal protective equipment. The virus has barely hit us so far in Boston. We're seeing that things like masks have to be largely rationed. We're starting to see people walking around with Ziploc bags with their mask that they can take in and take off again and not throw away. Gowns are running low. Hand sanitizer is incredibly running low. And so all of these things, I think we can anticipate that they will continue depleting. I don't know enough about the manufacturing process of this type of equipment to know where the limiting factors are. I know that we were speaking with the CEO of a company yesterday in India who said he can send our hospitals like 200,000 new gowns. And so we might end up looking to international partners to send some of these products if US and our main lines of connection for manufacturing of these products starts to be depleted. So our plans are essentially to use as few of these things as possible. And what that means is that we really need to be testing. And so it's turning into a little bit of a perfect storm where we don't have testing that makes everyone very uneasy in the hospital setting in terms of dealing with patients who they are not yet familiar with, especially anyone with any symptoms that appear anything like this virus, which in a hospital like Brigham Women's or Mass General, there's plenty of patients who on any given day look like that. And so many of them have to be considered presumptive positives without a test. What that means is that we have to then waste potentially a tremendous amount of personal protective equipment to go in and see those patients if we want to assume that they're positive and play it safe. Instead, though, what we're starting to see is while those would be the measures we would most want to take and feel best about taking for patient care and healthcare safety, healthcare personnel safety, we are starting to see really tough decisions being made by hospital administration and department administrators to relax the requirements for personal safety in order to maintain a stock in the hospital of these equipments, and that could put our healthcare employees at risk, which could compound the overall problems within the healthcare system even more. So it's not a particularly great set of choices at the moment.
Great. Maybe a couple just email questions that I got, and then we wanted to circle back on the treatment and vaccine side. But one is just, you know, is there any way to know what the R0 rate in the U.S. might be now following the measures that have been taken over the last couple days? And then as you think about kind of what, you know, success looks like in terms of these, you know, social distancing measures that have been taken in the U.S., how do you think about, you know, what the kind of success looks like in terms of infection rate broadly?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think in the R-naught question, so really now we're talking about an effective R-naught, and we're no longer, so some of the assumptions we normally make in mathematical models about R-naught are assuming things like homogeneous mixing of a population, and then we can do fancier models of age structure and contact structure and things like that. And I mean, the whole idea of flattening the curve, the real effort that we're trying to get to is to get an R-naught that's below one. And when I look around outside right now, I'm in the middle of Boston, and frankly, there were no cars driving. I drove here without traffic today. Restaurants are closed. I actually think that there's a very good likelihood that over the next couple of weeks, we'll drive R-naught below one for this epidemic, which ultimately means that we can potentially get transmission to stop increasing exponentially, can pass through its inflection point and start to decrease in terms of the numbers of new cases. So that's a good thing, in my opinion, that we can start driving the epidemic down really before a lot of cities have even really seen it come up. And that's the goal. The problem is to what end are we doing this? This virus isn't disappearing. This isn't something we're trying to make go extinct. And so I think this is where policymakers really have to get together with epidemiologists and say, what exactly does this look like? We can close schools and we can keep having people stay at home for a month, 2 months, 3 months. But to what end? At some point, people have to go back and this virus will still be lingering amongst the population. So what does success look like? I'm actually not sure. I think that their success has to be some balance between healthcare and economy. I usually am focusing on the healthcare and epidemiology bit and not so much on the economic consequences. But as anyone on this call knows, you know, the latter is as detrimental to society and probably more so. So I'm not quite sure, and what success really should look like in this case.
Okay. That's helpful. And then I guess back to remdesivir, in terms of you alluded to, based on the public data, there's some benefit. Remains to be seen how much. I guess, again, what would you consider kind of good enough from some of these studies? I know they're looking at days in hospital, reduction in symptoms like fever, looking at viral load. So as we see some of the clinical data coming out of the remdesivir studies, what would be good enough for you?
Well, I think good enough for me or good enough for remdesivir to be put on label for treatment of coronavirus are different questions. I think that anything that can reduce number of stays in the hospital is, one day of reduced length of stay in a hospital can make a huge difference in terms of bed flow capacity. Of course, deaths are a great thing to look at when we start to see reductions, but I'm more concerned. Deaths will, the most severe patients oftentimes won't be able to be saved. So what we want to look at is length of stay in hospitals, which potentially have much greater implications for the masses in terms of making sure ICU beds are available, ventilators are available. And I think anytime we can reduce length of stay in a hospital, and particularly in an ICU by a day or two, that would be an optimal outcome for a virus like this. This is still an acute virus, so we're not looking, that people aren't necessarily staying in the hospital for months and where one day wouldn't make too much difference. It's really, if we can cut one-fifth or one-sixth of the time off of a hospital stay, I think that would be a tremendous benefit. Of course, if it can do even better than that, and I think you'd have to get remdesivir into people early on in the course of their infection to do that, I think that would be even more optimal. But that would be good enough for me, and I think it would be good enough for most recommendations to use remdesivir.
Thank you. And we haven't touched on vaccines here, but clearly a number of companies are working to create vaccines against COVID-19. What are your thoughts on the various approaches? And, we also have novel science that's kind of stepped in here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think the approaches that are at the forefront right now, the RNA vaccines, are the science is terrific. I think they are the way of the future in terms of vaccines. One of the major reasons is because they can technically be scaled up and produced anywhere. To a large extent, and they can be modified quickly. As a virus starts to escape immunity, for example, they can be modified and updated just by a tweak in their genetic code, and you start printing a whole new vaccine. This is a major departure from how vaccines are normally produced, which is growing up viruses, creating proteins, lysing them, killing the viruses, and adding adjuvants and pushing them into people. In this case, you're essentially able to take a sequence, print it out, package it into a protein capsule, or any number of companies are using different forms of stabilizing the RNA and getting them into people. And that theoretically could be, you could have one laboratory anywhere in the world, you could have laboratories sequencing the virus as it's emerging and as it's spreading through the population, continue watching what that virus is doing, and continuing to update the vaccine as appropriate. The big problem with RNA and DNA vaccines is, there's never been one licensed for one. And I think they have a lot of promise in the future when people ask me, do I think that a vaccine is going to be available in 12 to 15 months, I certainly hope so. And I think theoretically this could be. We're amazingly seeing vaccine trials from Moderna go on, get into phase one already. That's like years faster than normal. However, what we are, these estimations of 12 to 15 or 18 months all make this very important assumption that the biology works. And we know we do not yet have a vaccine for rhinovirus, for HIV, for adenovirus, for a coronavirus. And these viruses are not like the vaccines of the past where they were essentially measles, mumps, polio, smallpox, all these vaccines that we're so used to getting as kids. These are vaccines that were developed in response to what are very famously sterilizing immunity driving viruses. So something like measles, you get it once and you never get it again. And there's something about those viruses that we're still not sure, but they elicit long-term, very robust immunity. There's something about these respiratory viruses that don't lead to that type of immunity that's just different. And we don't yet know why we don't have a durable response to influenza vaccines, and for example, and why other viruses seem to be causing so much trouble. We know a lot about them, but the real differences between the two is hard to capture. So I've cautioned very strongly that there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of rhetoric around the 12 to 15 month period. I want to believe it, or I want to have hope in it, I should say. But hope doesn't really go far relative to biology. Until we see the biology, I will have a hard time believing that the vaccine will become available.
Maybe the other area I know some companies are working on is developing an antibody approach. Any thoughts there? And then a second one, it relates to the IL-6 antibodies. I know that that's more treating kind of the symptoms, but any thoughts on either of those approaches?
Yeah, certainly I think monoclonal therapeutics are going to be the way to go. Those are easy to derive. We have come a long way in the last 5 years where we can now take a plasma cell pool from somebody during infection. We can capture their plasma cells that their body naturally makes in response to the virus. We can sequence those cells, find out exactly the sequence of those cells making the antibody. We can then produce that antibody and test many different combinations that come from even just one individual who ends up being able to control the virus to get a neutralizing antibody. And I think that will be the first type of therapy that we see that's a true antiviral benefit. There is a concern with antibody-based therapeutics as well as vaccines that you could get something like what happened with dengue virus, where we ended up having a huge backfire of that, and we got antibody-dependent enhancement. So if the antibody binds to the virus, but not exactly the way that it should, it can actually increase viral replication in the body and cause disease. That being said, I think there's going to be such massive interest for this virus to develop an appropriate monoclonal that's the thing I see coming first. And largely that's because I know from my own laboratory that I run, we develop these things. We work on antibody serological diagnostics and development of monoclonals, and the tech has come really, really far, and it's become accessible, and lots of companies can do this at scale now. So that's where I'd put my money, I think.
Okay. Great. We just had one more. It was just relating to kind of trying to understand the mortality rate. You mentioned some numbers at the beginning. Is it easy to know kind of how narrow or wide the error bars are around those numbers? I would assume that most of these cases are confirmed with a test, but just again, I guess it comes back to the testing question. But again, as we think about the ultimate impact of the virus, how narrow or wide are those error bars?
Yeah, I think we can look at how far what's the doubling time of this virus in the population? When did it likely emerge? So we can look to China, for example, And we could say, what's the highest that this, what's the greatest population that this may have actually impacted in Hubei province? And we can say, okay, well, it started in maybe late November, so maybe there were, and if each doubling time is around 5 or 6 days, you can calculate that out and maybe say, okay, even though there were 90,000 cases reported, maybe there were actually a million cases in Hubei province, and 3,000 deaths or 2,500 deaths or so. And so I think what our best estimates would probably put some error. I would say that there's no way we captured all of the cases that occurred, and we know that kids, for example, include a lot of cases that don't become symptomatic. So if we say that based on the doubling times, maybe there was a maximum number of cases so far in Hubei of around a million, maybe a slightly more, that's around a tenfold increase. So I would put the mortality, the true mortality rate, maybe would be somewhere around 0.3 or 0.4% in terms of infection mortality, with some error within that order of magnitude. I don't think it's going to be vastly a greater denominator to bring it down much lower than 0.3% or so, but I also I don't believe at all that the true value is 3%, which is what the numbers generally say, but that's mostly a sampling problem. So I'd say in the 0.1 to 1% range would probably be a safe bet, which is still an order of magnitude of error bars, which is not great, but that's fully it's a true problem with our ability to sample people.
And maybe just one last question here that just got sent in. What are your thoughts on the use of IL-6 in this population?
Well, I think it's really, really early. This is experimental. I mean, we use it as an immunological adjuvant modulation quite a bit. I don't feel like I can, I honestly don't think I could comment one way or the other to say that the data is really showing that it's going to be beneficial or not at this point. I think, I mean, maybe I'm hedging a little bit too much, but I think it probably would be beneficial if I were to take complete guess. There's reason to believe from an immunological perspective that it would, but we've seen so many time and time again where these things that seem like they make so much sense, like IL-6, that they just don't end up panning out. But we're learning a lot more about interleukins now and that whole portion of the immune system. And I think that there will probably be some benefit. Whether or not it ends up being worthwhile is a different question.
Great. Well, with that, we have come up on the hour. So, Dr. Mina, I do want to thank you so much for your valuable time today, and thank you, everyone else, for dialing in. Everyone, stay safe and healthy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
This podcast was recorded on March 17th, 2020.
This podcast should not be copied, distributed, published, or reproduced in whole or in part, or disclosed by any recipient to any other person. The information contained in this podcast does not constitute a recommendation from any Goldman Sachs entity to the recipient. Neither Goldman Sachs nor any of its affiliates makes any representation or warranty, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the statements or any information contained in this podcast, and any liability, therefore, including in respect of direct, indirect, or consequential loss or damage, is expressly disclaimed. The views expressed in this podcast are not necessarily those of Goldman Sachs, and Goldman Sachs is not providing any financial, economic, legal, accounting, or tax advice or recommendations in this podcast. In addition, the receipt of this podcast by any recipient is not to be taken as constituting the giving of investment advice by Goldman Sachs to that recipient, nor to constitute such person a client of any Goldman Sachs entity.